Welcome to the Hist 101 series on early medieval England. Today we are discussing the term Anglo-Saxon, the public's misconceptions, scholarly misconceptions and disagreements, and the history of the term. Since at least the early 1700s, the term has served as a primary designation for English culture and peoples before the 1066 Norman conquest. The strange thing is that neither early historians of the period, like Henry Spelman, a 16th and 17th century antiquarian, nor early pre-conquest English folks themselves referred to themselves as such. In recorded manuscripts, the pre-conquest English themselves referred to themselves as quote-unquote English. Now, let's get this thing out of the way. The Angles, the Saxons, Jutes, Frisians, and other peoples who were integral in forming early England absolutely existed. No one has ever contested that. No one is erasing their history. This is a study of terminology, how it has evolved, and why accuracy in terminology matters. Before we dig into the term's history, let's briefly explore the history of the field that concentrates on early medieval England. Early English studies is a field that has covered the history of the early English people. Broadly, it includes literary, cultural and art historians, paleographers, philologists, and archaeologists. It's quite a unique field with a mixed bag of scholars from differing areas of expertise. Historically, the field was perceived, taught, and studied within an empirical framework, which has most often created an implicit bias surrounding British origins. Although scholars have argued for updating the term for more than 100 years, the term has drawn more controversy in recent years with its use as a dog whistle to describe the quote-unquote white race. People like U.S. House of Representatives Marjorie Taylor Greene in 2021 described in the conservative America First caucus that, quote, America is a nation with a border and a culture strengthened by a common respect for uniquely Anglo-Saxon political traditions, end quote. Commentators slammed the phrase Anglo-Saxon political traditions, which many noted was a racist dog whistle. The backlash shows that the public recognizes the racism of the term Anglo-Saxon. Doctors Erik Wade and Mary Rambrand Olam have written a number of articles on the term, academic and publicly accessible ones, both together and independently. Their latest publication in the year's work on Old English Studies is on the term Anglo-Saxon, eugenics, and the history of racism in their field and how the term has been manipulated for hundreds of years. One of the things they discuss is how colonialist expansion was dependent on an Anglo-Saxon myth of white superiority and that was equally dependent on an all-white history in Britain. An all-white Britain wasn't ever so, but we'll get to that in a bit. We know, too, that the North American forefathers, like Thomas Jefferson, were obsessed with linking to a mythological Anglo-Saxon past and launching an Anglo-Saxon project. This is the same for Canada. The first Prime Minister, John A. Macdonald, a Scottish settler to what is now called Canada, came to Canada to, quote, civilize, unquote, the Indigenous nations, but ushered in an age of genocide of peoples, histories, and cultures in the name of imperialism. On continental Europe, French authors like Edmond Desmoulins, who wrote Anglo-Saxon Superiority, set out the doctrine of racial Anglo-Saxonism. It was translated into English in 1899 and became popular among politicians like Theodore Roosevelt. I've mentioned the US and Canada, France even, with regards to building colonialist agendas on a white Anglo-Saxon myth. But what about those on Britain? British mining magnate and imperialist Cecil Rhodes, born 1853 and died 1902, likewise employed ethno-nationalist colonialist rhetoric, stating in his 1877 Confession of Faith, quote, "We are the finest race in the world, and the more of the world we inhabit, the better it is for the human race. Just fancy those parts that are at present inhabited by the most despicable specimens of human beings, what an alteration there would be if they were brought under Anglo-Saxon influence. Look again at the extra employment a new country added to our dominions gives." End quote. Colonialists hearkened to a mythologized English past to justify their commodification and dehumanization of BIPOC, which is Black, Indigenous, and People of Color, in a global context. Dr. Cedric Robinson correctly theorized that this British tendency to expand globally in order to exploit, expropriate, and enslave was based on a, quote, mythical Anglo-Saxonism that was flown as an ideological pennant, end quote, by imperialists and politicians alike. Wade's and Rembrandt and Olm's most recent article explores how people like Rhodes and his contemporaries, like Charles Wentworth Dilke, born 1789, died 1864, an English liberal politician and fervent imperialist, also anticipated what he saw as a justifiable white genocide by people of color. Echoing today's white nationalist paranoia involving a white genocide, Dilke exclaimed that, quote, "The Anglo-Saxon is the only extirpating race on earth," end quote. However, quote, "the gradual extinction of the inferior races is not only a law of nature, but a blessing to mankind," end quote. So Dilke considered the genocide of BIPOC as natural and a blessing, but not so for white people. Moving into the 20th century, British Prime Minister Winston Churchill, 1874 to 1965, espoused ethno-nationalist views that relied on a mythologized past. In 1943, Churchill stated that he despised people with, quote, "slit eyes and pigtails," end quote, and, quote, "hated," end quote, people from the Indian subcontinent who he claimed were, quote, "a beastly people with a beastly religion," end quote. Churchill claimed that he didn't, quote, "really think that black people were as capable or as efficient as white people," end quote. Even his U.S. contemporaries recognized his racism. U.S. Vice President Henry Wallace contested Churchill's notion of Anglo-Saxon superiority. Churchill responded by asking why he should, quote, "be apologetic about Anglo-Saxon superiority," end quote. Churchill's racist rhetoric offers insights into some of the appallingly imperialistic and racist political decisions he made throughout his later career. At the height of the trucker convoy in Canada, one of the people who spearheaded the protest, Pat King, had this to say.
"Now what it is the part of the depopulation. And a lot of people don't understand what that means, and what there is there's an end game. It's called depopulation of the Caucasian race, or the Anglo-Saxon. And that's what the goal is to depopulate the Anglo-Saxon race, because they are the ones with the strongest bloodlines. And we'll leave it at that, because then we get into a whole different topic. But it's a depopulation of race, okay? That's what they want to do. This kind of behavior then endorses less procreation. All right, so the less procreation, the less white people, or, you know, Anglo-Saxon. Let's say Anglo-Saxon, because when I say white, all the Antifa guys call up the race card. So we're going to call ourselves Anglo-Saxon, okay?"
Those aren't dog whistles. Those are megaphones. Anyone denying that the term is being used as a synonym for white superiority at this stage is lying. And let's be clear. There is no "yes, but" when it comes to racism. Now, for those who believe that this is a new phenomenon, let's go back in time and address something else attached to colonial narratives that relates to early England. What is an Anglo-Saxon? The early English period begins in the early-ish 5th century, probably, most likely before the fall of Rome, since archaeological evidence points to the fact that some of those migrating folks, that is, those Angles and Saxons et al., began arriving before the collapse of Rome and just sort of blended in with the rest of those on Britain. So who was there before these Angles and Saxons and Jutes and Frisians settled on the island? Let's rewind a bit and start earlier. Before the Germanic settlers came to Britain, Britain was in large parts part of the Roman Empire. Of course, the Scots, being Scots, weren't going to give in to being ruled that easily, and so they and the Welsh, that's Picts, Celts, and Welsh, were generally successful remaining free from being swallowed up by the Roman Empire. With Britain as part of the Roman Empire, though, there was certainly travel, migration, and an in-out flow of peoples from various parts of the Roman Empire. In a nutshell, Britain has never been isolated. This goes for Ireland, too, where we find in the 9th century annals of Ireland a record of the landing of the Blue Men, and blue was how both the Irish and Norse referred to black folks. There are useful discussions by geneticists on isotopic evidence of people arriving from Africa to Britain. This certainly peaks in the Roman period, but it's highly plausible and likely that their descendants could or would have continued to live there. There's plenty of archaeological evidence of significant contact with Africa and the Byzantine Empire in post-Roman Britain and early medieval England. Dr. Caitlin Green has done a number of summaries of analyses about isotopic analysis of burials in Western Britain, which suggests people from Africa were actually being buried in England in the post-Roman period. What this means is that there was trade and interaction and migration to Britain from Africa and the East, and that archaeological evidence continues to shed light on the varied people in the early English period. We could go further back to the Belbeker people, that is, those peoples that were on the island even before the Celtic Iron Age Celts and Picts. Not much is known of them, and they've sort of just disappeared. But even before them, about 10,000 years ago, there were hunter-gatherer Mesolithic people in Britain who geneticists and archaeologists determine looked like this. So why are we going back this far when we're supposed to be talking about the term Anglo-Saxon? We're getting there. But as good historians, to understand today, we have to go backwards. This is a good time to remember what indigeneity means. The indigenous peoples today of the Americas and Africa, the Sami people, and those in parts of Asia and Australia have existed in these places of land for not just 1,000 or 2,000 years. Their histories and connections to these lands go back nearly 10,000 years, and there is archaeological evidence that we can draw on, there are oral histories, and of course scientific evidence that has yielded in ways of understanding these people's histories. For someone who works on historical narratives, 1066 is not the ancient past by any definition. The people, those early English, comprised of a variety of different peoples all mixed together, but mostly Germanic migrants, those Angles, Saxons, and others who blended together are not ancient, and to have arrived after the fall of Rome does not make them indigenous to Britain, particularly when there were people who had lived or were living on the island well before them. Some may argue that there were not significant numbers of black or other people of color in Northern Europe in the Middle Ages. That's a strawman argument, attempting to speak from a position of authority on what number of non-white people would be or is ever enough in order for them to count as English or British. For most racists, there is no amount of time on Britain that is significant enough for some to convince some that black or brown people are even British today, even those who were born on the island. And for the record, many of the people who changed the cultural and religious trajectory of England forever came from Africa. So what is this Anglo-Saxon? Up until this year, there were only 3 known references of the term Anglo-Saxon in the Old English corpus. Doctors Kemp Malone and David Wilton identify 3 Old English examples of the term, 2 10th century royal charters and 1 Latinate poem from a 10th century manuscript. In all 3 instances, the term appears as part of a title, in the genitive plural, in a Latinate 10th century Old English text. Wade and Rammer and Olam discovered a 4th instance of the term in a likely 10th century Old English text, the translation of an 8th century papal bull granting privileges to the Malmesbury Abbey. Now keep in mind that these 4 instances are in Old English, but they aren't in the first person as an identity marker. A few uses of Anglo-Saxon in Old English seem to be borrowed from the Latin Anglo-Saxones. Manuscript evidence from pre-Conquest England reveals that kings used the Latin term almost exclusively in Latin charters, legal documents, and, for a brief period, in their titles, such as Anglorum Saxonum Rex, or King of the Anglo-Saxons. The references describe kings like Alfred and Edward, who did not rule, nor claim to rule, all the English kingdoms. They were specifically referring to the English Saxons differentiating from the continental Saxons. Scholars have no evidence that anyone before 1066 referring to themselves as an Anglo-Saxon in the singular or describing their politics and traditions as Anglo-Saxon. While one might be king of the English Saxons, nobody seems to have claimed to be an English Saxon, in other words. So think about this. In a period, this early English period that spanned over 600 years, there are 4 instances of the term in the vernacular language, and the other references are in Latinate forms, and all these were attested from only 73 years. Let me repeat that for you again. In a period spanning nearly 700 years, the term is found and used in a span of 73 years. Anglo-Saxon and Latin documents in pre-Conquest England is confined to a few royal texts about Alfred and his immediate descendants. Seven kings used the term almost exclusively as part of a slightly obscure royal title. Continental writers used it twice as long to differentiate the English from continental Saxons, but this term wasn't adopted by those on England. So if we're looking at this from the perspective of scholarly accuracy, it's not accurate. As historians or dilettante, we should be using accuracy over tradition. The term Anglo-Saxon fell out of use for some 500 years in English records and was picked up again when antiquarians in England were reflecting on pre-Conquest English peoples. Wilton points out how the term popped up again at the same time that the term the Middle Ages emerged. Think about what was happening or emerging during the 16th century in England. 1520 is said to have begun the, quote, Age of Discovery, unquote, because this is a nice way of saying that the next period in European history was the beginning of colonialist expansion. Between the 17th and 19th centuries, an English nationalizing agenda emerged, centering on creating the myth of an English race. The success of the agenda was dependent upon appropriating and refashioning the past. Post-medieval English discourse was concerned with what it meant to be English, and those of pre-Conquest England, particularly the, quote, Anglo-Saxons, unquote, served as convenient symbols of national liberty. For English reformers and Victorians of the 18th and 19th centuries, the period before 1066 provided a pseudo-origin myth story of national liberty in England that had been obscured by the Norman conquest. English political and religious discourse sought origin stories to amplify a pure Englishness, which meant that glorification of the period before 1066 became a necessary weapon in linking racial purity to those seeking to conquer new lands in the name of England and later Great Britain. The fact that the term Anglo-Saxon has become synonymous with white and a litmus test for purity, when in fact that's not historically accurate, and it has been weaponized for racist purposes to harm and exclude others, are reasons why we should consider the term's use more carefully. It says a lot about a scholar or layperson to so adamantly defend a term that has been completely adopted into the rhetoric of white supremacists in English or white nationalists, and has been part of that rhetoric for hundreds of years. Framing this issue as an American problem is irresponsible and lazy. Sociologists, modern historians, a growing number of people in the medical field, and political scientists agree that racial Anglo-Saxonism is an organizing force in Euro-American spheres and imperialism. As Wilton states, quote, use of the term by medievalists is out of step with everyone else, including other academics, end quote. Non-medievalists understand that this modern racial ideology is built on a specific idea of medieval history. Dr. Surgeon Vucetic's 2011 monograph, The Anglosphere, A Genealogy of a Radicalized Identity in International Relations, features an image of the Sutton Hoo helmet on its cover as a marker of the role of the medieval in modern racial politics. Only medievalists are slow to come to terms with this reality. White medievalists misrepresent BIPOC scholarly arguments as recent and politically motivated, ignoring the century or more of white medievalists who called for the term to be replaced. Medievalists continue to argue for the retention of the term Anglo-Saxon, often through criticisms of proposed alternatives. Scholarly debates about the inaccuracy of the term Anglo-Saxon have been ongoing for more than 150 years. In 1861, historian Francis Palgrave, 1788-1861, posthumous publication of the History of Normandy and England argued against the historical use of the term Anglo-Saxon. Palgrave argued that there was no Anglo-Saxon nation and no Anglo-Saxon language, and he advocated for historians using the term English for both the people and language of pre-Conquest England. In the same decade, historian Edward Freeman, 1821-1892, maintained that Anglo-Saxon was historically inaccurate and that scholars should replace it with English, since it should, quote, be a sound rule to speak of a nation as far as is possible by the name which it calls itself, end quote. In 1929, Kemp Malone argued that the term Anglo-Saxon implied the pre-Conquest period was not part of the history of England or the English language. Malone asserted that medievalists should replace Anglo-Saxon with another term. In 1985, historian Susan Reynolds argued that the early English period was itself, quote, too long and contained too much change to form a significant unit for study as a coherent period, end quote. She argued that, although the term may be difficult to remove in the, quote, terminological world of historians, we might do well to remember that the early medieval English did not call themselves Anglo-Saxons, end quote. Much has changed in the decades since Reynolds wrote about the term's accuracy, and Mary Dockery Miller's 2017 summary showed that the term was cloaked in whiteness and weaponized by neo-Nazis in recent years to glorify the greatness of their European heritage. Other scholars like Drs. Reginald Horseman, Cedric Robinson, Matthew X. Vernon, Renato da Silva, Paul Edward Montgomery Ramirez, Geraldine Hang, Haruko Mama, Adam Miyashiro, Daniel C. Remien, Catherine Karkov, Donna Beth Ellard, Sharon Rhodes, and others have delineated the problematic nature of the term and recommended that medievalists replace the term Anglo-Saxon with another more accurate and or less racist term. So there is a history of the term being called into question that people have not properly interrogated. By framing this as a recent controversy or calling scholars cowards for not taking back a term appropriated by racists is to ignore how long scholars have been seeking to correct an inaccurate term. When should we use the term? Some people are willfully missing the point entirely if they think we should not use the term Anglo-Saxon in cases where it's recorded in historical texts. Nor are scholars saying that Angles or Saxons or otherwise didn't exist. There has never been a campaign to remove the term from usage in historical documents, and anyone suggesting that is being disingenuous. It's a complete exaggeration and in some cases fabrication. Where the term was used in the past in historical documents, you quote those texts accurately and continue to cite things properly. Old textbooks and references should be used similarly, and if one feels more comfortable using the term with quotations to signal its use in a historical context, then do so. It's not hard, and we've made changes to the Dark Ages, Aryan, and other terms. In the 2019 aftermath of the International Society of Anglo-Saxonists name change, a group of largely UK medievalists established a Forum for Multidisciplinary Anglo-Saxon Studies, or FMAS, and released an open letter calling for the term Anglo-Saxon to be retained. They argued that the racial use of the term was American. Their only direct mention of white supremacy was a reference to the racially supremacist Anglo-Saxon clubs of America. They purposely did not mention Churchill, Cecil Rhodes, 19th century Prime Minister Benjamin Disraeli, and others, who all use the term Anglo-Saxon in a way to signal white superiority. Dr. Benjamin Salzman pointed out that FMAS's name was unfortunately chosen because the top results on Google for Forum and Anglo-Saxon was a UK-based white supremacist website that had a popular forum called the Anglo-Saxon Foundation. Arguments to keep the term are grounded in racist rhetoric, whether it's coded or explicit, but we've done our research too, and some of us have no personal attachment to colonialist terms. A recent scholarly work in medieval studies entitled Europe and the Anglo-Saxons argues for the usefulness of Anglo-Saxon in scholarly discourse and dismissal of other alternatives. The author argues that, quote, in the UK, English and England feature more prominently in extremist language than Anglo-Saxon does, end quote. The book neither addresses the fact that the word English describes both a language and a nationality, nor advocates that scholars should not use the term English in their work. This reveals an astounding disregard for racism towards the Black, Asian, and minority ethnic populations in England, who are in fact English, but who cannot nor wish to call themselves Anglo-Saxon. English or American or Canadian are not white-only designations. Reassessing and re-examining the field while also looking at it in a different light is not meant to shut out more traditional or conventional research. The point of revisiting and interrogating the language and terms we use is no different than any other type of scholarship. By simply referring to ourselves as Old English experts, or Early English experts, or Early Medievalists, or Insular Saxon experts, or other options, makes more sense. It does not erase past work. So, is this a US problem or not? No, it isn't. As has been demonstrated, most especially over the past couple of years, this is definitely not just a US problem. We've seen that this is a problem in the UK, Canada, Australia, and in other countries where English imperialism left its imprint. This is a deflection tactic so as to not to have to deal with the racism within the UK Academy. All one has to do is Google racism and UK Academy to find articles that show subtle and overt racism embedded in the British Academy. Linguist Dr. Mark Sundaram makes a great point in his talk on the inaccuracy of the term by questioning why there has been such vehement backlash to calls for responsible labeling, particularly in the UK. His talk will be linked in the description below for those interested. Despite claims that English and Old English are also problematic, they do not carry the historical colonial baggage that Anglo-Saxon has. This sort of whataboutism is often deployed in efforts to divert attention from addressing the reality that Anglo-Saxon is not rooted in early medieval pre-conquest vernacular and is used as an exclusionary racial marker. Such arguments position advocates for updating Anglo-Saxon as outsiders and allow traditionalists to perpetuate the idea that their views are mainstream. This delegitimizes corrective efforts and undermines endeavors to understand how whiteness operates within the field. Finally, a lot of people say we need to take back the term. Firstly, take it back for what reason when it's not even accurate?
And finally, the question, is reclamation of the term desirable or even possible? The claim is, it is an honorable and valid position to defend and insist upon a historically and interpretively correct use of the term and to reclaim misinterpreted features of the early Middle Ages where necessary rather than abandoning them. Now, as we've already seen, Anglo-Saxon is not a historically and interpretively correct use. It's a marked term throughout its history. Anyways, this is a bit of a misunderstanding of how linguistic reclamation or reappropriation works. Usually it refers to an external slur that's being used to disparage a particular group being adopted by the group that's being disparaged. In this case, that doesn't hold, right? This is a term that was originally being applied from outside, but is currently being used by the group to build themselves up, not to disparage other groups directly. What it does suggest, however, is that anyone who isn't Anglo-Saxon is somehow lesser, right? So there's no mechanism, therefore, to reclaim the term. There's no way, for instance, to stop white supremacists from using the term.
Secondly, who is we? Are scholars of color and those who are directly harmed by white supremacy, other marginalized voices in marginalized and other intersecting communities supposed to sit back and continue to be denigrated because traditionalists can't wrap their head around a white supremacist talking point? But who is we? Are traditionalists literally fighting white supremacists? When do they speak up and denounce white supremacy? One scholar on the former ISXX had the caucasity in 2019 to say that she was feeling unwelcome because she was probably Anglo-Saxon. All this proves that some British scholars are truly emotionally tied to this term. They say other scholars are emotional when arguments are rigorously backed up with linguistic, literary, and historical evidence, and yet they claim to emotions, claiming that they feel sad and excluded. Projection and emotion is at work here. This white supremacist movement in Euro-America has used the term Anglo-Saxon to justify racial violence and colonial genocide for at least 200 years. The racial meaning throughout the English-speaking world has deepened and come to be associated crudely with whiteness. Anglo-Saxon has become a supremacist dog whistle, reinforcing the idea of the Anglo-Saxon race as a supposedly indigenous group in England, suspiciously erasing the fact that the Angles and Saxons were migrants. 1066 allows white supremacists to see the Normans as a foreign conquering force, and periodization reinforces that. Maybe the age of discovery is just beginning, because we're starting to realize as scholars, institutions, laypeople, and students that Europe isn't the center of time or the universe. So let's recap. The term is barely used in pre-conquest England, 4 times in the vernacular and a handful of times in Latin, mostly to refer to law codes, etc. It was used for 73 years of a nearly 700-year period. No one used it in the first person. Continental writers used it to differentiate from continental Saxons. The terms used by the people of the period were Angles, English, Saxons, mostly. The term dropped out of usage for 500 years and reemerged during the Age of Colonization. It became weaponized along with colonizers to advocate for white superiority and was utilized by colonizers. At this time, it became synonymous with white and was used in eugenics and race science. It is not just an American problem. Mostly white British scholars are often attached to the term because it gives them a sense and link to something that they won't admit to: heritage and ethno-nationalism. There are black, brown, and other POC who are English, and to take that word away from their identity is actually racist. Taking back a term that is inaccurate is not good scholarship. Terminology matters. So what can you do? Don't hang on to colonialist baggage. Update your language. It's literally that simple.